Now, he played senior intercounty football for 16 years, won 5 All-Ireland titles and 4 All-Star awards. Former Kerry GAA player Darragh O'Shea joins us now to tell us about his autobiography, where for the first time he talks about his life in the green and gold and about his constant drive to succeed. I thought it was 6. Do you want as a substitute one? Does that count?
Six.
Apologies there. Good start. One of the greatest players ever to put on the green and gold, I suppose, is a fair comment. Whether or not you agree is another thing.
I wouldn't agree with that, no, but I had a great time doing it. I mean, it was 16 years, and it's only when you kind of sit down and look back in it, and I think of all the games. And, I mean, we probably lost more games than we won over that time, but it was hugely enjoyable, and the friends I made over the years was very enjoyable as well.
Were you surprised at the reaction to your announcement earlier in the year that you were calling today?
To be fair, I mean, they've been better players than me and will be better players than me come and go. So, I mean, from that point of view, I understood where I was in the pecking order, but it was just, I suppose, I had no intention of writing a book at the start of the year, but then when I decided I wasn't playing, there was a couple of people came to me and said it, you know, and I suppose put the idea in my head, and then I just went about doing it because I wasn't doing anything else at the time. And it just took off from there, and I suppose it's out now, so I hope I didn't offend anybody.
Well, your Uncle Paddy, who was no mean player in his own right, said that you were perhaps one of the greatest midfielders ever.
I don't think he's biased either.
Maybe slightly, but I mean, I think it'd be fair for
you to agree. I suppose very often when somebody retires like that, people say kind of things, you know, to bring it on. But definitely, I was lucky to have played with some of the best players, the likes of Maurice Fitzgerald, Seamus Mine, and I suppose in modern day Colm Cooper and these guys, you know, so they're real guys that you'd kind of look up to.
Some great players. Well, I remember going down to the Kingdom and I met Wishy Fogg. And he's telling me, like, sure, you can go to any pub there and there's fellas with 4 and 5 All-Ireland medals. The fellas with more than that are the special ones. And in a way, it struck me afterwards, that kind of makes it harder to get into the Kerry team because, you know, there's so many young children striving to make the grade.
Well, it is. It's a huge part of everyday life down in Kerry. And it was always, for me, it was a huge ambition to play with Kerry. But the people, it's. I know you go everywhere. You go to the shop, you go to the pub, people are talking about it and stuff like that. But it's a good way. It's a good thing in a way because it kind of puts that pressure on you to perform. And it kind of gives you an extra kind of bit of pride as well whenever you're going out in the field and that. But they're demanding supporters, but they're the best in the world as well, you know.
You probably could have gone on for another season or two if you'd have wanted to. Now, all right, you might have found yourself being brought on as an impact sub or something, or you might have held on to the place. Was that temptation there? Or did you say, no, I know it's the right time, I'm getting out now?
Well, it was. I suppose the temptation is always there. I mean, you can, you know, I probably could have, in some capacity, probably made a stay on. But I remember playing in the All-Ireland final last year against Cork, and over my 16 years, I suppose it was probably the most physical game I played in. And you know, I remember, I suppose in the quarter final and semi final against Dublin and against Meath respectively, I had been taken off, and I probably wasn't happy about being taken off towards the end of the game. Yeah. Now, obviously, it was a tactical move and whatnot, and the management were doing what they were doing. But when I was taken off in the final, it was time to go then because I was spent, so I kind of decided after that, and I said yes.
Great innings.
Yeah, looking.
And just for people who may not be aware, I'm sure there are very few of them, how difficult is it combining, you know, on Gaeltacht, Kerry, a wife and a young family, working, all these things have to be accommodated, but you know, priorities have to lie with your family, have to lie with the Kerry football team. So how do you organise that and keep going through it?
Yeah, I suppose it's easy enough because I suppose, you know, when you're starting out, I mean, football is a priority. And then as you get older, you get married and you have kids or whatever the case may be. And obviously priorities change over the years. So it's just a case of time management. People say, like, I often look around, what was I doing? What do I do with my time now?
But yeah.
I can tell you, I'm still quite busy with different things, you know. But it's, as I say, it's great. It's probably the best feeling the world to go over to Killarney on a summer's evening and train with 30 bodies, like, and have a good crack, and the banter that goes with it in the dressing room and stuff. That's probably the stuff you miss the most.
You miss the most. There's the book is very real in that it's not just about your career, it's about you and who you are and where you came from. And there's a very poignant chapter concerning your dad who passed away. He was just 60.
He passed away in 2002, actually. So it was actually immediately after a Cork game, the day after a Cork, we played Cork in the championship. But it's something that touches every household, I suppose. But it was just, I suppose, the fact that we were just so involved in the football at the time, and probably, you know, we were trying to grieve as well at the same time. But as I say, it's something that has hit a lot of households. But obviously, we're very close to our dad as well. So it was a tough time, but you know, no more than anybody else that it goes through that, you know.
And he didn't get to see a lot of you and your brothers then in the green and gold jersey.
Well, he saw us, the three of us, play the previous Sunday, I suppose, which was, I suppose, I said he probably had enough scene, I suppose, at that stage. But no, we went on for a couple of years after that, and we're lucky enough to be around for a couple of All-Irelands after that, yeah.
Who or what was your best memory from your long career in terms of opposition?
So many, you know, I suppose. Yeah. Lucky enough to have played with some of the best footballers and played against some of the best footballers, you know, the likes of Peter Canavan and, you know, these guys. But I suppose my first All-Ireland in 97 was a huge thrill because Kerry hadn't won the All-Ireland in 11 years. And in Kerry, I suppose, they feel it's a long time.
Yeah.
No sounding arrogant or anything like that. But the celebrations and whatnot. I remember there was a 50-year anniversary as well that year for the Polo Grounds, the game that was played between Cavan and Kerry.
Yeah.
So we were actually playing Cavan in the league, so they brought us over to New York for the last league game, so we had a great crack over there.
Brilliant.
Yeah, a great couple of weeks, yeah.
And you got to represent Ireland as well.
I did indeed, yeah.
The International Rules Series.
It was good, yeah. Brian McAniff gave me my opportunity and John O'Keefe, so
Kevin
had a great
Fagan
time.
Might have been on that trip as well. Kevin Fagan might have been on one of those trips as well.
We had Kieran Whelan from Dublin, there was Pádraig Joyce and Michael Donnelly from Galway, so there was some great players and some great cracking trip as well. Like, you know, I mean, you meet great fellas and you can have a bit of fun over there as well.
Is there anything you would do to improve the standards now for the current GAA players? Is there anything that should be done, do you feel?
I think our games, I suppose, are in the current climate. I think just our games are probably one of the most positive things that we have at the minute. You know, I mean, our even there's a big surge in rugby as well, but I think football and hurling, I think, there's a great kind of sense of pride in it at the minute. And I suppose the only thing I would say, I suppose, is just to kind of the policing of the games, you know, the refereeing and the discipline side of things. I suppose while discipline has to be there, I suppose it could be just managed a bit better. I think, you know, we just to move with the times. I think, like, I mean, with our decision making. But other than that, I mean, everything seems to be working
right.
Way fine.
Now, I didn't get a chance to delve into the chapter of Paul Galvin and that famous or infamous match now against Clare. But for people at home who are interested in GAA, it's a fantastic chapter and it's reason enough to buy the book, which is in all good bookstores. Dara, my story. Dara, you'll be signing copies of it when in Easton's in Tralee on Thursday at 5 o'clock.
That's right, yeah, that's right.
All right, well, listen, best of luck. Lovely meeting you. Thanks
for
coming
in
this morning, and every success with the book.
Thank you.